very soon. In fact, we're here right now for our first draft between OMG and QT, and the Thresh is actually the first ban away.
Does Morgana make it through picks and bans? Doinb has shown, even if the matchup doesn't even suit it, like we can understand back at MSI, Morgana versus LeBlanc, not happy times for Morgana, but a quite competitive matchup. That was a decent scenario, but Friday, picking it against Cassiopeia, a very poor matchup for Morgana. But Morgana, the unique thing, throw down that puddle, leave the lane, no aggro taken, pushes the wave very well. You can always be competitive, but you're certainly not looking for any semblance of a solo
kill. Yeah, that was Flandre's reasoning, I think, why he loved the champion so much. It's always fine.
What are you going to do? I've got the black shield on. See you later. I'm leaving.
Exactly. As Hecarim's the second man for OMG. Azir, Kalista, the next two there for QG. Uzi, I don't think he's going to see that champion many times. Kalista, that is.
I mean, he doesn't necessarily always win on it, but his mechanics just unbelievable on that champion. Just really,
so
really
good.
Impressive. So, ban it away to stop that worst case scenario of the hop, skip, and jump pentakill.
Yep, and we can see ban missed there, I think, for OMG. May have been a penalty there that we weren't aware of, but no third ban there for OMG means that QG gonna look to see what they want for their last
ban. Jungler's Paradise so far.
Yeah, no Jungler's banned. I mean, Rek'Sai's a decent ban on the red side if you're QG just to take it away, but plenty of options available for the last one, and the inevitable first pick as Maokai is actually the last ban.
So the whole jungle pool is available. Screams, Gragas, or Rek'Sai first pick. Not really sure where Zhuezhe will go. The Gragas was definitely the better of his two performances on day one, so Gragas first pick I would say will be likely. He's just mousing over a few picks. Mordekaiser, Ashe. This is actually 5.8, so no reworked Ashe just yet. Now that will probably be disabled on the next patch. So a few weeks away from one of your favorites hitting the Rift. A lot of things being open. Wow, Gnar is the first pick.
And that's a new champion, I believe, for Xiang in the top lane. So going to be taking it away. Gnar first pick, a fine first pick as far as I'm concerned. Very flexible, decent matchups across the board for the most part. Especially with Maokai ban, I think it's reasonable. But we'll see what happens here as QG having some fun with their first few picks. But we've seen a lot of Alistar priorities. Sivir's seen some picks there. And of course, the big one, Rek'Sai, is still open.
Rek'Sai is the strongest champion, in my estimation, available. Gragas is right up there, depending on the comp that you want to run. But there's no rush to lock in a jungler, because look, maybe Rek'Sai's what, a hair's length ahead of Gragas, but you'll be happy whatever you get.
Wow.
LeBlanc, Alistar, they get both the burst assassin and the best support at dealing with this assassin in the first rotation.
I like the Alistar a lot. We've seen lots of teams go to that as a first few pick. It does leave Sivir open. They instantly pick it up along with Gragas to OMG, but Doinb's got a new champion and Morgana didn't get banned.
But Zhuezhe gets the Gragas, and more importantly, Uzi picks up the now 14-2 Sivir. Sivir comps this whole year. As soon as Uzi joined the lineup, it was only really Sivir that seemed to promote lots and lots of winning for OMG. Their win rate on that champion looked so much more comfortable with that pick. Looking over on the QG side, maybe going to take the Irelia into Gnar matchup. We've seen it once so far this weekend, and Irelia was able to win, but there were multiple things helping Flandre get that matchup over the line. Casting your mind back to the LCK final, you can see that this matchup has started to warp maybe towards Gnar with excellent itemization like the new Black Cleaver. I feel like it'll move towards Gnar more and more, but if you get enough lane swaps, if you get enough shenanigans going that Gnar has to build for the team fights, there's always that point where Irelia can use level 7, level 9, and Trinity Force to overcome the pesky little Gnar.
I think Koro did it in the MSI final as well, so there's definitely contention on both sides, but Rek'Sai, Irelia, the picks for QG. My big question is, how did Swift get Rek'Sai this late here? But Orianna's gonna get locked in, Nautilus will join it for OMG, and their draft already it's done.
So much early power. We've got LeBlanc, Rek'Sai, very strong ganking duo in the mid lane. Excellent lane to gank in the top lane with Irelia with the Equilibrium Strike. Alistar again provides CC in the bottom lane. If there's a lane swap, roaming Alistar and Rek'Sai is CC train central coming through to multiple lanes. So a lot of early power. Doesn't mean that their late game is going to fall away either. It's this unique situation that we seem to be placing on 5.8, where once again, the last pick will be AD carry.
Yeah, that's two games in a row, at least quite a few this weekend actually as well. And Graves is the pickup there
mid
for
game
TNT.
Central.
Yeah, I mean, QG, we talked about them being an aggressive young side. That certainly showed in their series against LGD. I have good news for you QG fans out there, and there's probably a lot of new fans after what happened on day one. QG are not slowing down at all in this series.
A lot of the LSBO experts told us that, look, if it gets to the late game, if they can't snowball a lead, it's not necessarily QG's late game team fights that get them the victories. Not necessarily their strategic plays, it's earlier rotations, it's strong mechanics, it's getting that win sewn up in the first 10 to 15 minutes, and man, they've picked themselves in a situation where if they can do that, they will do it with style.
Yeah, and they've picked completely to just take over the early and mid game and snowball through, so OMG, be interesting to see if they can weather the storm. They must feel comfortable with their draft, but I don't know if any team's going to sit across from QG and feel that comfortable at this point.
I don't know about the QG coach being quite so casually attired. No suit coming through at all. Don't know about these rules. A bit lax in China.
Is his hair crazy, though? That's all that matters.
His hair was crazy.
They're perfect.
So crazy.
Matches the team, then. It's Weijie versus Swift in the jungle. Gragas versus Rek'Sai. Is Cool going to take the classic counter pick? Orianna into LeBlanc.
Knows a lot about both these champions, the LeBlanc side especially, usually the aggressor. Sivir's win rate really makes OMG a bit favorable this time. Sivir and Nautilus, very similar to Sivir and Alistar or Sivir and Annie. Very engage heavy support, going to really be sped up by that Sivir on the hunt. The 300 base movement speed, so much higher when you're popping that ultimate. I like the fact that both of these teams have identities, but how much work can QG get done in the first 10 minutes will really decide who wins this game.
Well, they got it done in the first 4 minutes last time. Let's get onto the Rift and find out. And welcome back for our first game between OMG and QG. It's an old-school Chinese powerhouse up against the upstart newcomers. And QG start 2-0, OMG 1-1, unfortunately, for them on their first week of the LPL. But Uzi's back with the big winner, Sivir, from this week. And we're going to have a pause just to slow things down ever so slightly. QG, their aggression must be contained somewhat.
And QG, they play their own style. They're all about aggression, and they pick for it. They definitely know what a game they win looks like, and they don't try and flatter to deceive. They don't try and counterpick. They pick their own comp, and they try to win with. That's usually the sign of a strong team. If you're spending your whole time counterpicking or respecting your opponents, you're probably giving them too much credit. Play your own game, and this is an OMG lineup that isn't necessary to be feared as much as previous lineups. On paper, looked so strong at the start of the 2015 Spring Split. As far as we know in the 2015 Summer Split, they've got a lot to really prove.
Yeah, they do, and I think we'll have to see both of these teams really step up as the season moves through. Very exciting for QG, of course, and OMG, a team that everybody loves to see win. But I have to say, kind of looking through Cool and Doinby there, QG at least have the hair game locked down, because Cool's hair, you could see that it was like a mop almost. It was a shrubbery.
It's just the hair central game. You already called the first team. You backed yourself into a corner and said they were the boy band, and then the real boy band came out with the
trolled.
Sick hair. I mean, there was lots of people on Twitter confirming the same thing. When you see that big squad shot of the QG, they all know what they're doing.
They do. I mean, you know, cleverly designed marketing strategy there, and some pretty cleverly designed strategies as well. So have been a fun team to watch so far. Can they outmatch the level 2 four-man dive quadra-kill pentakill that happened in that first game? Because there's a high bar to set in your first game of the LPL.
We're going to see some pentakills or more craziness. Maybe they just need to combine both. I want to see the four-minute pentakill coming through from QG. Look, if they can win against OMG, they will make a name for themselves, both from their play, from their crazy hairstyles. And if you can build a Western fan base with a name like Chogo that's very hard to pronounce, you're doing something right.
You are indeed. But Uzi and Amazing will start on the bottom side of the map, going to clear out the Krogs. Seems like the Grump is the order of business for QG there as well. So standard lanes here, and I'm excited to see how TNT in his aggressive grabs does against Uzi, the classically over-aggressive Chinese player.
So QG are going for the bigger camp, so they will be sharing the experience. They want Alistar to get his level 2, which makes a lot of sense. Pinging level 2 at the same time, we're talking about quick draw buckshot potentially at melee range with the changes on 5.8. Wave clear options for Graves goes down because, of course, his max range Q, basically the bolts out the sides, don't do as much damage. But at melee range, as has always been the tuning way, more and more damage.
Yeah, I mean, Graves' all-in's pretty scary. We've seen a lot of level 2 all-ins just today already, actually. So Uzi and Amazing will have to control this Graves in the early start of the wave. But Sivir's win rate does not lie this weekend.
Worth noting that TCT has taken heal in this lane, so they don't have Headbutt Pulverize available. They know this to OMG, so the aggression is very measured from OMG. Might as well go in aggressive because they don't have to worry about that huge mini Malphite ultimate.
And Uzi, as always, will force you to fight for every CS that you want, and you can see pressuring aggressively, keeping a CS lead, and Uzi, he doesn't matter if he wins by, you know, 2 or 20 CSE. He just wants to have an advantage over you.
Swift is mid lane very, very fast.
That is early there. Maybe looks for the flash. No, just forcing the cleanse from Kool, but Swift, if he revisits in that situation again, Kool's dead.
I thought he might even look for the flash. Between the cleanse flash, would have lived. So probably smart to hold on to the summoner spell. Gragas just went for the much more passive choice of just completing all the camps he had available and didn't take the Scuttlecrab, hasn't even taken his second buff. It would have been unanswered aggression in the mid lane. And speaking of aggression, Swift's not done.
No, Swift is never done, let's be realistic. Right now he's going to visit his blue buff, but you have to think he's going to look to gank another lane.
It's just very, very present. His pathing is really impressive because his pathing gets him a similar amount of CS to his opponent, but also navigates him towards the mid lane, gets a gank on the route as well. Very, very impressive players. We're going to see the debut of Xiang on this Gnar.
Yeah, V actually playing Aurelia as well. Going to get some good trade damage in. In fact, Doimby's roamed up at level 3. Really fancying a kill. Goes in, finds a chance. Can he complete the tether? No ignite. Couldn't get in range. But what an aggressive roam by the mid laner.
Super aggressive roam. Crucially, even if he'd ignited, wouldn't have been enough damage. Didn't quite have the burst. Was about an auto attack away, but would have just died to the turret in that particular regard. I like the front footness, though. He knew that Orianna was playing so defensive with cleanse down and with Rek'Sai already showing pressure in the mid lane. Free roam. Gets a summon, doesn't get a summon as well, gets a lot of pressure, and now draws the teleport out of Xiang.
And Doimby, really smart play on top of that as well. I think kind of played a mind game there as V just dives back in onto Xiang. Damage going to come through. Gnar does have his summoner flash up, but not the teleport after that. And Doimby's actually back to CSing. I think those extra potions paying off there.
And V's showing no respect whatsoever to Xiang's Gnar by maxing W first, not even putting a second point into Equilibrium Strike. Usually with all the CC and the amount of space you can open as Gnar, you'd expect an Equilibrium Strike for just any sort of equalizing traits to the Aurelia, but he's looking for kill pressure.
Yeah, Uzi though, continuing to farm nicely, and Swift's back here. Kool's going to get nailed by another tether. Swift comes in, finds the knock up there, and Kool's forced to flash.
This has just been repeat city, and the jungle pressure between Zhuezhue and Swift has been night and day. Zhuezhue always on the back foot, where Swift, as we expected in this matchup, always trying to make things happen.
And Swift still ahead in CS as well there, so like you mentioned, still pathing intelligently, taking his ganking windows very well, despite how narrow they may be. And the bottom lane's fine, but that's the only lane that doesn't feel under immediate threat right now.
And the important thing to conclude for the viewers is there's no excuses for Zhuezhue. He's on a ganking jungler, also in Gragas. Both these junglers have the options of being flexible and either farming or ganking, but he's just finding time to gank and farm at the same time in a very even pressure matchup.
Swift's actually counter-jungling now as well, so deduced correctly that Zhuezhue is on this side of the map, so goes around, just takes away, I believe, the Grump and now the Wolf Camp as well. So just with the Hunter's Machete, this Rek'Sai's done so much work, and Kool might be in trouble once again. I think he knows what's coming. Does get the knock-up, chains will land, ignite down, and Kool is finally dead. First blood to Doinby.
And that is the culmination of 6 minutes of jungle excellence and pathing from Swift. Doinby deserves a lot of respect as well for finding time to go top, but QG, a 6 minute of masterclass from both the jungler and the mid laner.
And I believe both the Korean players of the side there, the mid laner and jungler,
correct,
much like Kakao and Rookie, showing a lot of synergy early on.
I mean, impressing me even more than Kakao and Rookie, to be honest, which is a big thing to say given that they took the KD roles to Arrows to the OGN finals and an OGN title in 2014. Kakao and Rookie had a lot more practice and a lot more showings than the LPL, but just from the limited tape, Swift and Doimby deserve to be in the conversation.
Looking good so far. Here is V, also with a bit of extra pressure. He's got a Phage already in this matchup. 10 CS up as well. Xiang, the new top laner here, used to be a mid laner, played support for OMG as a sub last split. Maybe going to struggle here in a matchup because V is just pressuring so hard.
And look, he's picked a counter matchup that, again, we've said has gone kind of both ways. But it's against a player who's new to the role, so he's just confident that I'm just going to dominate you. That's why he's gone Phage. He's happily put multiple points into his W. He just doesn't think that Xiang will have the mechanics, which is a kind of a dangerous precedent because if one thing Xiang had in his Syndra or Morgana days was mechanics, the all-in comes through and Xiang can't do anything.
That actually might be a kill. Xiang does have his flash, but doesn't need to use it. But the pressure's relentless here from the Aurelia. Crystal and Flask Charge going to charge up a bit more of that mana. And Zhuezhue, not even level 6 yet. Swift is level 7.
And he's still has flash.
He does indeed. Going to keep going in. Find Zhuezhue. This actually might just be a kill. Gragas can't do anything at this stage. Does get the slowdown. Preyseeker not going to land, but that blue buff's gone.
That's a crazy, crazy move from Swift. He went in with no vision whatsoever. He knew he'd either find a buff or find an underlevel opponent, but two levels? crazy.
I mean, both his laners in top and mid are ahead as well. So Swift, it looks crazy, but he just felt so safe.
They picked the matchups though, Pastry Time. Nah should be winning the top lane, but this is probably just more of a skill differential, at least in top lane, between V and Xiang. Doenbi's got the more aggressive side of the matchup in mid lane, and they've spent so much time relentlessly ganking, blowing first cleanse, then flash. Now cleanse is back up, but the death has already come through. So both lanes winning, both lanes reacting with CC. It's a jungler's paradise, but it's only for Swift.
Look, Swift deserves so much credit here, because that invade works so wonderfully when you've got two lanes ahead already. Sure, V got ahead because he just played well in a matchup that's fairly skill intensive, especially in early levels. Cool's been conditioned to sit in this spot in lane. He is never leaving now to stop you if you enter the jungle. So Swift spent 6 minutes basically conditioning Cool to do what he wants, and now he's got complete free reign in the top side.
And that's both the matchup and just the play from Swift. So yes, it's absolutely a 1-2 punch that has caused Cool to just be a complete non-factor in the mid lane. It's reminiscent of, say, a Syndra versus Orianna matchup where you might feel like you're going to be assassinated on rotation. He can't even rotate halfway down the lane to pick up CS. Yeah, such has been the pressure from Swift. So yeah, when you have strong lanes, it's very easy to be an aggressive counter jungle, but they've picked for this scenario. So they know what they're good at. They pick for it. And so far, 10 minutes in, they've executed as well.
And I think Swift might actually be coming down to the bottom line next, which would be, again, a very smart play given what he's shown to OMG already. But Uzi holding fast in the bottom side. Both backs coming through from the AD carries actually have merited them some early BF. So it's Uzi with a pair of boots, so a slight lead there. But Chui Chui, level 6 now, but potentially caught out with the Tremor Sense.
I mean, one word we don't usually talk about when we talk about Rek'Sai is snowball. But the thing that's actually snowball about this game, unfortunately we don't have, yes, we do have on the for a second on the screen there, is the minimap. He actually has tunnels in both the enemy blue side jungle, his own red, and his own blue side jungle. He's level 8 at this point, I believe, as well. He's all this is aggressive pathing, and obviously using the tunnel off cooldown every time means that his global ability to globally react is huge. But man,
that collateral damage was massive. TCT, though, gonna go down there. Amazing gets the next kill. TNT, great flash to dodge it, but a massive teamfight means that OMG starting to take over. Swift gonna fall as well to Uzi, and that's 4-0 as V. He's stuck in the top lane with his teleport.
Yeah, the five-man roam down bottom, unfortunately missed the starting action of that, but it's been massive for OMG. Undoes a lot of QG's work in the first 10 minutes. We were talking about flawless execution. Something obviously went awry as a huge amount of advantages, and suddenly a 2-0-2 Uzi emerges at 10 minutes.
Yeah, Doenbi, I believe, caught in transition. In fact, we're going to see it again.
So we're going to see the replay coming through. Amazing is just engaged on 1v3, but it's five members have committed here, and as far as I know, Irelia doesn't have teleport. We can't tell for sure. The first kill is picked up. You might think they'd stop going in, but Xiang is building up his Gnar bar at this point. He's getting it higher and higher. Still doesn't have it, but they're so tanky, and they have three members who can tank Terra that even after the burst, they continue the engage, and this is where we caught up to the action. As long as they tank the turret smartly, which is never a guarantee, but QG managed it 2 days ago, OMG doing their best QG impression, nets them 4 kills.
Very nice dive there and gets them straight back into the lead. Actually, Xiang though, gonna find Doenbi. That's not who you wanted. Irelia gonna follow through. Needs to time this over for the hop, but Xiang, too much damage. Good distortion though, gives Doenbi the kill.
Good spacing and use of the skills. Doenbi was just waiting to see if he tried to bounce over the wall. Happily picked up the kill. OMG gonna try to answer with Dragon. Dragon's what got them that advantage with the 4 kills they got off the back of a contest around Dragon, but LeBlanc shows in mid and they have to back away.
Swift though gonna try and get some wards back. TNT will return to the bottom side. The Uzi has pushed in aggressively. He actually got double buffs off that last exchange. So TNT has ahead at 2-0-2. This is not the Uzi you want to have on the other side.
One kind of story point we didn't get to mention, we might still not get to mention, is the mimicked chains actually popped from going back to the distortion in that particular case, that TNT and Uzi are no strangers. They were in the same Royal squad post-Season 3 Worlds. Uzi moved to the mid lane after Tabe retired. TNT was one of the AD carries they tried out, I believe, mostly in off-season tournaments to replace Uzi. So they at least know themselves personally. They've played together on the same team. That's just another little story to add to what's already been an explosive 12 minutes of action.
It has 6 kills already in the first bit, and QG have not disappointed us with action, but neither of OMG. Is Joy Choi going to come back in as well? Doenbi actually could be in a bit of trouble. Great shockwave there from Cool. We'll line it up with a teleport this time for V. That jungler is dead as Gragas goes down and Swift claims that one.
Yeah, teleport came through, doesn't even get a kill assist in that situation. Was looking necessary in bottom.
Yeah, Uzi going in aggressive, but TNT on the graves. This is a bit more power in this sort of duels.
QG Games bring action if nothing else, Space Jam. They're behind in the kill score, but 600 gold ahead, mostly because of the top lane matchup. As expected, the seasoned top laner in what is traditionally a counter matchup, doing very, very well. 30 CS is the advantage for Irelia over Nar.
Yeah, got a dagger and an amplifying tome, interestingly. So kind of split the difference on the Sheen and the Zeal, but we'll be moving in towards that Trinity Force fairly soon. Swift going to clear out the ward there as well. So continuing to get vision around and trying to, again, keep that blue buff in his control.
It's crazy to think, but actually amp tome and Zeal is probably the most damage you can buy with two components. You don't need the mana at this point if you're just going for all-in trades. The crit strike gives you situational damage, but even though the amp tome is only, what, a 0.5 ratio onto the E and then a small ratio onto the ultimate, still relevant enough to just go there if you want to burst down Xiang.
And you know what? V definitely wants to burst down Xiang from what we've seen. Level 10 already maxed out the hit 10 style, continuing to bully Gnar there in the top side of the map with 20+ CS already in the lead. No teleport, but he's going to go back because he's got some gold to spend.
Speaking of gold, Sivir with that extra gold from the big kills, two parts of the Infinity Edge, but the cheeky Avarice Blade ahead in CS and with an Avarice Blade. We're talking about 10% more efficiency for at least those smaller creep kills with the +2 gold on hit. That's going to help Sivir try and open up this lead, and with the Infinity Edge completed at 14 minutes, easily going to do that is Uzi.
He's got the Infinity Edge now as well, actually, so just finished it. But I have to tell you, Papa, I think there's a sale. Wow, TNT actually ults the wave there to clear it out instantly. Cute stuff there, but there's a sale on Avarice Blade, I think, for Sivir players in the LPL this week because everyone is buying it.
What I want to see is OMG rotate over to the Dragon. When you see the Graves walk up and ult the wave, you know that he is exiting lane and he will not have that collateral damage available for the next dragon fight. You 100% know that he's backed. You know that he doesn't have the critical ultimate that's so much of his power in the early game. It'd be a mistake not to start the dragon, but OMG, they're on four.
They do. They start the dragon in full vision of QG as well. Never mind. Ward gets cleared away there thanks to the raptor buff there from Chui Chui, and that dragon goes down. That's the first of the game, and it does go to OMG.
And just victories snowball in ways that you don't always see on the gold or on the kills and deaths pastry time. Just because of that extra goal was able to push out a wave back in a favorable spot, force TNT to go for a back using ultimate to just hope to push in the wave to ensure that no freeze happened. And okay, he stopped the freeze, but he gave up a dragon. Yeah, so that's all from the 2-0-2 and the extra golden items that Sivir could pick up.
Smart stuff there. And Sivir continues to do some winning here, at least in the early stages of this game. Xiang, big chunk of damage there with V now having that Sheen. And I don't know if Gnar's really happy in this lane anymore. Giant's Belt, Double Cloth Armor, not too bad as far as mitigation goes, but Irelia just taking over this matchup now as Uzi pops the ulti, wants to kill Ricochet, not enough. Ignite is enough to get the kill, and Amazing claims it.
That's just a burst trade onto the Alistar. Didn't even have to use the depth charge in that situation and still pick up the kill. Maybe just too slow on the trigger finger when it comes to the Unbreakable Will. Swift continues his journey, though.
Yeah, actually does get the Grump. Oh, that was close there. Xiang with a nice boomerang. Hops to safety there as well, but the bottom tower's down, and like the last season here, OMG's bottom lane's starting to get ahead early.
It's a familiar story. Top side of the map on the enemy team, bottom side of the map on OMG's side of things. That's always seems to have trended over to what has been the advantages for this team. They've subbed out Gogoing for this untested Xiang. Doesn't really seem to be working out, although at this point he's building for team fights. They're really going to have to win those team fights. They've got a very strong Sivir to try and build a victory out of, but specifically the jungler and the top laner are far stronger than their opponents.
Yeah, Gnar being behind means that Sivir ulti is going to send a very under-farmed and under-leveled Gnar into the fight, which is probably not how you want to start things off. Cool can make it work, but he needs a bit more damage. Got the chalice, but needs a big, you know, second item like a Rabadon's. A Swift coming in there onto Xiang. Wants to get the Umbra in a perfect spot to do so, as V going to dive back in as well. And Xiang, I don't think he's going to get so lucky. He actually does get out of the way, but Swift, another wonderful gank.
You're not confident enough to go for the full-on turret dive. Even with the Trinity Force being completed, didn't feel like they had quite the burst damage to do to go under full tank Gnar under turret. Still not one item. The Uzi fans have some cause for optimism. Uzi himself has done very well in this early game. The gold's all tied up. the pressure's been arrested a lot of the ways for OMG, just not so much on the top side of the map.
No, it's, you know, as you said, bottom half winning for OMG and top side not so much. Cool, again, is kind of the bridge that needs to lift up OMG from his position, and he's played just fine. He's actually a bit behind in CS after all the pressure that Swift applied to him, and Doinby's kind of had free reign of this lane so far, but Orianna will get stronger, and OMG, maybe that second dragon, that's where they want to fight, because Uzi especially, like you've said, he's so strong. He's been involved in every kill at 2-0-3.
So Doinby actually changed around his item because he wants to get an upgraded yellow trinket. They have double upgraded yellow trinkets. This should be a hugely overwarded map. It frees Swift to not have to pick up a Sightstone to go along with Cinderhulk. He's actually gone for a super, super early locket. That's a very fast snowball locket for the jungle compared to, as you can see, his opposite number with just a Cinderhulk and a Sightstone. It's a teamfight build. They want to opt into teamfights and disregard the shockwave damage. Honestly, at this point, with just Athene's being completed, the shockwave's just going to be, for CC mostly, going to tickle the backline through the locket. I really like this itemization that's come through because now the pressure's off the jungler to do all the warding.
It's really nice to see some teams kind of using the trinket system in a newish way because that changed, you know, with the upgraded system, making swapping that much easier, even though it costs you a bit of gold, does open up a lot of cool strategic plays. So I like it a lot from QG, and Xiang does not like this, although two more members of OMG trying to bait him in, but V spotted it out.
It shows quite a lot of restraint. He had a lane ward, so I know, I think he's seen at least one of these members, possibly both of them, come into lane. He's just trying to be creative and buy as much time as possible because now his other laners can do whatever they want.
TCT's here as well, so if he can make it back to his turret, he's probably not in too much danger. And Swift apparently lives in the enemy jungle because he is trying to counter jungle at every possible turn.
Now, a lot of his early work was undone from the 3-4 kills that OMG picked up. They want to take down this turret. Sivir's not even going back to it, so they will get it eventually. Has the Void Rush available, so can definitely rotate to top. He's level 11 also. His opposite number, level 10, definitely over-leveled on the jungle is Swift.
And you know, that's just a credit to Swift's great early game players. He's back in the top side, amazing. He's still hiding in the brush here, but now Uzi's going to join him and they'll try and take out another turret.
TCT happily sitting under the jungle as well. They're looking for Cool.
Oh, Cool gets nailed by a chain, just missing there. The shockwave might save him. Cool trying, but Shui Shui late with the ulti. Xiang's poured it in as well. Swift will be slowed. Hop moves in. Swift has to be careful. No tunnel just yet, but turns it around. Doinby will join in as well. Good knockup to buy a bit more time. Now the Hellbot's coming through, but Swift does fall. Doinby caught out now as well, but Xiang gonna get bursted down into Meganar. Finds the wallop. Good juke there from Doinby. Shui Shui now in trouble, gonna go down. TCT collapses as well, and QG gonna find, yes, another kill. Uzi trying to make it work, but too many people here. Amazing has to be careful. Uzi pops his ulti, maybe goes back in. He's feeling very, very, very manly, but V finds a dive, pulverize in, and Amazing's dead as well. QG, amazing team fight.
Really nice team fight there. Uzi was thinking 1v4 was a possibility, but they just waited for the flash pulverize to come through from TCT. It was a nice rotation from TNT, actually got the kill credit with just throwing through the collateral damage. Swift teleports back in with the Void Rush. The dragon spawns in 15 seconds. They're in position for it, and this jungle just keeps farming.
And look, with Uzi's items that he just got, Static Shift plus the Berserker Grips and the Infinity Edge, I don't blame him from going for that 2v4 effectively with his support, but he was about one well-timed spell shield away from going full Uzi once more.
So we're going to see the replay. Swift lives a long, long time because he's got so many extra items. Even used the Chilling Smite to try and dissuade any sort of engage. The teleport is channeled through. OMG honestly should be backing away. Maybe they're baited by the fact that Xiang actually got into Mega Gnar form. Notice he hasn't used the Gnar ultimate just yet. Ends up getting burst down. Finally, Gnar's just for damage at the end and falls. We don't get to see the rest of the fight as it looks like Dragon is going to really start to be contested.
Yeah, it's back alive here, and TCT's ready to charge in with his Moby Boots, Sivir ult on the other team. So not going to be able to use that one, but QG just going to start at the Baron straight in OMG's face.
Well, they just put down 200 golds worth of pink wards just to try and guarantee this particular Dragon. They pull it out very, very well. The Boomerang Blade will be able to hit it, so the Speculative Steal, we've seen Stranger Things earlier today. The slow dragon, they want to make sure they don't let it re-aggro.
Yeah, releasing it there as well. So very smart stuff. We'll take it away, and that's the first for QG. So equalizing that objective up 2-1 in turrets there as well, and about 3,000-4,000 gold ahead. So OMG, still plenty of wiggle room here, but Doinby going in. Gets shockwave as a result. Body slamming there as well. Xiang coming in. Massive now back, but he just now dies as Gragas gets the kill. TCT gets evaporated by Uzi, and they are diving well and truly under this turret. Swift, the next target, may just live here because he's so tanky good. Lockett there as well at the end. Uzi throws out the boomerang, doesn't quite get it, and TNT might just have to ult the wave again.
Domi made the unforced error. TNT, oh, though.
That's too deep there. Hook lands as well. Amazing. Very strong skill shot play there to clean up the AD carry. And that tower's dead as well. A big misstep for the newcomers.
Just too cute was the play from first Domi, and then at the end, TNT. They did not need to put themselves in position to die. Just let the outer turret go down. You would not have lost a second, but the second will be the result. That's a big win for OMG, who have been struggling in the objective game this game.
Yeah, equalizes the gold pretty much there as well. Only 300 now between the two teams. Finally cracked the mid turret's important as well. And Uzi once again, 4-1-3 on this Siva, leading the charge. And we keep talking about it. Siva's win rate looks to be only going up from here.
The rookie mistakes, they weren't apparent in the series against LGD, but they're finally starting to come through here. If anything, over-aggression seems to be the big issue or the big teething problem that QG might have coming into the LPL. On the one hand, it serves them well. Aggression can get yourselves into situations where you can win games that otherwise might have snowballed away. But over-aggression is what cost them a couple of turrets and probably was the large stimulus for that turret dive that got OMG the first four kills on the board.
And now QG have to really start worrying about the items from OMG. Aegis done there for Gragas. Randy Wenzomen completed there for Xiang's Gnar. The Rabadons is now done for Kulin. Uzi's only getting stronger. Even Nautilus building a Righteous Glory is not too far off that pickup as well. So QG's items aren't bad by any stretch, but that big team fight potential that OMG were looking for, they're now enabled to actually look for those fights now.
And yeah, we have to come back to the comps when we talk about their items. While their items are slightly ahead, it doesn't really matter much when the scaling is only going to get better and better for OMG towards the end of this game. So the only thing you can really hope for from QG is just say, okay, we're competitive at this point. We're slightly ahead in gold. It's mostly a wash in that particular situation. We just need to refocus. We can't afford to lose any fights from this point forward. There's always a tipping point. Usually it's going to be maybe the sorceress shoots into Void Star for Orianna, just so she starts doing relevant burst damage to what is a mostly squishy lineup coming through from QG, especially to magic damage outside of the locket that's been picked up by Swift. QG have picked a mid-game lineup. It's the mid-game now. They certainly haven't got themselves the lead they might have thought they had when they just relentlessly pursued into the mid lane to knock down Kool and really take him out of this game. Everyone's started to find relevancy except for maybe Xiang on the side of OMG. And with the Sivir ultimate, you can always go in.
Yeah, amazing. Just finds an ulti actually there. TCT maybe now caught a great ulti there from the Gragas there as V gets knocked back in. He dives in onto Uzi, but Orianna takes him out. Now TCT might get caught out. The ulti's still ticking, but it does not last that long. And Shui Shui gonna get the next kill. That's 2-0 OMG.
And OMG are playing very basic League of Legends. Group with Sivir, press the on the hunt and get picks and acquire kills. They're looking to try and actually force action onto this Baron. Assertive Baron's one of the reasons Master 3 looks so good. Doinby, though.
Doinby, sick. 1v1. No, doesn't quite kill Uzi. The collateral damage tries to find it, but Uzi somehow lives Preyseeker. Not going to be lucky there either. But that does leave OMG off the Baron.
It does take OMG off the Baron. It's still very successful move coming through from Doinby. I believe already had his death cap at that point. Now adding an extra Nidalee's Large Rod, going for by far the most damage on this LeBlanc build. Will have wave clear options and also solo kill potential, especially when the Void Staff comes through.
Yeah, that's off quite soon here as well. And Dragon back up in a minute 52. That's our next pressure point here in this game. We're currently split on the objective 1-1, so we'll see which team can try and get it. And I think for QG, it might be slightly more important because 5 dragons, that's another reasonable way to keep themselves in the game or win it, honestly.
I don't think it's that important for this comp. You know, when we usually talk about outscaled comps, you might say, okay, but they can always pick up the 5 dragon stack and have the percentage stats. I think with the Graves especially, they're just looking to try and take this game out early. They want to try and burst down. But they're basically fully burst-related in fights, whether it's LeBlanc, Graves, or even Aurelia's damage is mostly going to be about the burst coming through from the Trinity Force procs. Burst comps will naturally fall off in the late game compared to sustained damage. So they need to get the objectives now, and they're going real aggressive onto Amazing.
They are, but the ball zones them off there. TCT trying to find a line in, but takes a big chunk of damage as a result, and QG going to get completely denied. I like that V was split pushing down the bottom. I was surprised he didn't do it early, but that teleport's going to undo all of the pushing.
It teleports up, now doesn't have the ability to teleport into a fight. Xiang will be the first person to pick up a teleport, as his will come off cooldown in about 2.5 minutes' time. Xiang, again, still just has some of the parts of his team fight build. He will not be a split push threat. He has definitely been outscaled by Aurelia this game. Whether that's an important factor or not remains to be seen.
And that was part of the reason why I was surprised V was sticking with his team so much. I understand he wants to fight. He's strong in trades. He can CC people and there's a ton of burst damage, but he's one of the best ways for QD to get themselves a lead in this game is by forcing pressure to his side of the lane, but instead he stuck with his team and they just couldn't find the fights they wanted.
It's a fair point. This situation where Gnar just can't stand in a lane with the Aurelia and not get chunked out. Maybe when teleports are equalized, that's another strategy that QG can return to, but they haven't employed it to the fullest. Perhaps it's just the fact that Jiang was priced into grouping with his team because he just didn't have the teleport.
Yeah, I mean, definitely needed to stay true to his team, and it's been helpful so far as Dragon is back available. QG are the ones that find themselves with the Speed Shrine, and both teams going to look to fight for this Dragon. I mean, if QG want to fight, they can try and bring it to OMG, but I think OMG are the ones that really want to fight.
Yeah, both of them are looking for fights, but kind of for different reasons. OMG want to get in the objective game. QG just want kills.
Yeah. Gragas, though, kind of shaking off that damage there. I guess the last chain didn't land there to proc the Mimic Sigil, but Troy not taking too much damage right now on the Gragas.
I got worse news. That was actually just the Command Protect, I believe, coming through the call, just negating the Mimic.
I mean, Rabadon's, that's part of the reason it's so good on Orianna. You get a lot from that flat AP. Swift might try a steal. Doesn't look for it, though. Instead, wants a flank there. Finds Uzi, potentially, but just a prey seeker. They're getting a bit of vision. Uzi now realizes that Swift might be a little too close to his team, but OMG, they back away slowly.
They pick up the objective under the noses of Swift and QG and don't even have to worry about a fight afterwards. And as you mentioned, maybe just happy to fight with the Last Whisper. And even a Negatron cloak completed from Uzi, probably going to be the QSS, you'd have to think. But even has the backup after the biggest amount of damage with those triumvirate of items of a bit of extra magic resist to deal with LeBlanc's burst. And between the Orianna shield, that Negatron cloak and the spell shield, not a lot of kill pressure onto Uzi coming out of Doinbee.
Yeah, we can see the other reason that Kul's shields are so strong right now. He's actually skipped Boots 2 and gone for a second need to see La Drod after Death Cap. So a good Prey Seeker there from Swift will spot out OMG's little brush gank, but Kul is so good at protecting these carries. There's plenty of mobility, good disengage options, decent engage options there as well. OMG's team comp really coming up now.
And Jiang's about to have his teleport up as both the top and bottom lane minion waves were pushing for OMG. So they've once again culled them very well and find themselves in great spots. Aurelia might want to go down bottom to attend that wave, but doesn't have teleport for a good 2 minutes at this point, so really has to be careful with her position.
Does indeed, and TNT actually sort of out in the open here, going to clear out a couple of waves, doing decently on the item front, but not quite up to the Last Whisper just yet. And Uzi, it's not a QSS that he wanted to turn that Null Magic Mantle into, it's actually a Spectre's Cowl, and there's a Bilgewater Cutlass.
It's a lot of power, and just a lot of gold he was holding on. That's, I believe, 700 gold to finish the Spectre's Cowl and then a 1,400 gold purchase of the Bilgewater. He's just buying power where he wanted to. The Spectre's Cowl will make him that much more durable. Banshee Veil and Spell Shield means that LeBlanc no dice when it comes to assassinating the Sivir. The only option they really have is Aurelia getting on top of the Sivir and just burning her down with damage. And even then, the health coming through from Banshee Veil will be very useful in that scenario as well. The split push is on. Aurelia doesn't have teleport for another minute. So there's lots of options, and that's why OMG, with the threat of teleport, can get all the wars they want around Baron. There's just no way QG can test because it'll be outnumbered.
Yeah, Xiang's actually going in here. They're going to start the Baron up potentially. Ward's going to get cleared away. They know V's trapped down the bottom. Kul's actually in base. Doinbee doing good damage, and OMG, that's a misstep there. Take way too much damage from the Baron and waste the TP.
They didn't have Kul in position. I can understand why they wanted to try this scenario. There was the smart rotation coming through. Jiang's caught, takes a burst, and it's half his health.
Yeah, good damage though, but Kul does come in with a Command Protect to keep him safe. Did finish his Zhonya's, which is why Kul was back in base, but OMG, gonna have to play these fights a bit more carefully.
I mean, the Zhonya's could be an important factor. You never really know because the ball position, how it interacts with Zhonya's, then you have another second for that Kul cast time of the Shockwave. So Shockwave always gonna be the most notable factor of a team fight involving Orianna. The builds are coming through thick and fast. Graves hasn't shopped and purchased in quite a long time. He will at minimum have a Last Whisper if that's what he wants to purchase when he backs.
Well, TNT has hit the recall button. Gonna head back to base and there's his Last Whisper. Does sell the potion, gets a couple wards, so apparently nothing else apart from that.
Okay, so he still has a lot of power, still going to be mostly about burst. Going to be hard to really get a lot of auto attacks in as a 525 range carry against an Orianna, who doesn't really need to use that ult for initiation, have multiple other initiation options on his team. And if you just hold on that cooldown, Graves, more than most AD carries, has to respect the ball because he doesn't even have the spell shield like one of his fellow short range carries, Sivir. He just really has to be on the ball when it comes to avoiding Orianna's damage.
He does, and V, knowing that they're around the Baron area, it actually does come back. QG might want to force a fight. Had his teleport up available, Xiang does not have his, so QG can commit to pressure in other lanes with the Aurelia if they so desire, but level still wanting here for TNT, especially once that level 16 going to be there relatively quickly as he's about a fifth of the way through that progress, and just looking through for that. Items across the board looking decent, but both teams at this point almost waiting for the next dragon.
Items in the advantage of QG, composition in the advantage, and AD carry in the advantage of OMG. So it's really a fine line between a team fight win for either team. It feels like a pick needs to happen for QG before they win a fight, but you just look at the difference in items. The AD junglers is probably the clearest example there. Cinder, Hulk, and a locket for both of them, but then a completed Randuin's the case for Swift. It's basically a Randuin's ahead of his opposition compared to just the 200 health and the wards provided by the Sightstone. The item's looking wonderful for QG, but again, engineering a pick when the wards really have come down for OMG is going to be difficult.
I mean, just the CS values between the junglers as well. Swift has 160 plus CS already, and Choi Choi hasn't even cracked 100. So Swift, again, strong ganker, very aggressive, but great pathing as well. He's put himself in a great situation. It's probably the reason the gold lead's fairly close, only 1,000 up for OMG right now. But Dragon's going to be back soon, and Swift, all that gold in the world means nothing if they can't find a way to close the game out.
That's the question. They need a pick, I think, on paper, preferably onto Cool to be able to win a team fight. If Orianna is able to freely auto and move around the ball with command attack, it's just so hard for QG to navigate all the threats that are on the side of OMG and win a fight. They have great wards around the map, some defensive, some offensive. We're waiting for a point to fight over, and I guess the next dragon is the most obvious point of call.
Yeah, both teams waiting pretty patiently here for the objectives. Xiang, Mega Knight form, has a Banshee's Veil now actually to go along with the Chain Vest and his Randuin's plus the Ninja Tab Eye. So going to go back, maybe spend some gold, but needs to stack a bit of Rage up moving in for that dragon. Shui Shui clearing minions out as well. Cool also with his Silk Shoes now, so even more damage coming out from that big, big Shockwave. But again, team's just going to set up for Vision. OMG moved to clear it out, and QG had some good setup wards right now as well.
Swift was being donated the farm in the bottom lane. That's one of the unique factors. Maybe taking a page out of EDG's book and giving Swift a bit of extra gold, like is often the case with Clear Love. His purchase after he had those tank items we spoke about, the Locket, the Randuin's, and the Cinderhawk, actually the Phage, so maybe it will be Black Cleaver from the jungle that we kind of wondered about but have never seen. So maybe even damage carry potential coming out from the jungler.
Now you can see all teleport actually coming through there for V. So going to zone them off here. OMG, don't quite want to go in just yet. Dragon getting low. Swift will return to try and smite it away. Good hook to land for amazing. Massive knock-up though from TCT. Now in TNT getting dove in on the back lane. Ult is going everywhere, but Thornby dives in. Almost takes out Cool with a flank. Zone is his pop. Xiang though with a massive ulti. And OMG just going to clean it up, but Thornby diving back in. Uzi flashes out of the way, and TCT, the only one left alive and not for very much longer.
They did not respect the Orianna ultimate. Triple Orianna shockwave onto all the damage dealers led into the world's best Gnar ultimate against the wall from Xiang. It all lined up for him. It didn't require any savvy mechanics like Koro's. So they pick up all the kills. They walk over to Baron, and OMG, it looked pretty dicey for them, but the moment we came out of some of those technical issues, they've really burst forward.
Yeah, going straight in onto the Baron now. Plenty of Baron damage left, especially given that QG won't be in the area to contest it. Do have to tend to some of these side waves. QG have done a great job pressuring those, but Baron's going to go down. They'll go back, spend their gold, prune those waves, and look to push.
Just a lovely wombo engage. It felt like QG had options to deal with a TNT, for example, dying with his flash available. Actually was just on the corner, just on the tip of the shockwave radius. He might have thought he was safe. He certainly was not. Swift Void rushes back into the dragon pit. Might be able to take down this objective. it'll only be 2-2, but at least it delays a possible fifth dragon further into the game.
I mean, equalizing dragon is fine. I think QG are right to take it, especially if they gifted it like this. Don't want to die, though, and teleports are coming in. TNT, an obvious target. Xiang going to run in. Banshees comes through. Silver Ultimate pops. Shui Shui looking again. Finds a mini stun into the wall for V now. They'll slow him down, and Gragas so sticky when it comes to CC, even with the Aurelia passive there. Good stun coming in. Good wallop, though, from Xiang. So many stuns. A shockwave to secure the kill. They do get it, but Uzi off to the side, he's in trouble, and it's amazing, actually, that gets picked off by Doinby. Now OMG gonna keep moving through. Doinby a bit out of position, but he's trying to find assassinations.
Yeah, OMG frontline, do not take damage anymore, page time, between the Gnar and the Gragas. You can see the swigging that cast, taking no damage. The fight continues.
Oh, good pulverize there for TCT, but Uzi far too tanky and too much peel. TNT going back in. Uzi, great spell shield there coming in. TNT's going to go down, and Doinby finds no way back in.
It's one of the reasons we no longer see Graves in the metagame. Just doesn't do damage to these frontliners. Doinby's doing decent chip damage to the Gragas with three items and then a bonus stats, but it's not enough.
Yeah, I mean, Doinby's still getting chased, probably able to get away distortion. Fairly low cooldown at this stage, so OMG overchasing a little bit here for this last kill, but Doinby still getting chased, just buying time and using the cooldowns wonderfully.
Yeah, he's just trying to distract. That's his main job at the moment, is to look tasty to Zhui Zhui and friends, to try and stop any more pushing to come through from OMG. Even Aurelia is going to be in position to stop Xiang from taking an unanswered inner turret. So in terms of objectives, not that many claimed by OMG.
And that was the issue with all the sideways being controlled nicely by QG, is that OMG win a fight wonderfully, but Dragon's kind of already down, can't take that one away, and all of a sudden they look to push and there's just no ways for them to prep.
The big problem though, Page Time, is that we talked about ways for QD to get back in this game. Short of a pick, you could see TNT three autos onto a Gragas with the Orianna ball, the Orianna shield on top of him, could not even break the shield. And this is with Last Whisper, Infinity Edge, and a Phantom Dancer. Graves is not going to do relevant damage, is so prone to being caught in the radius of Shockwave. In terms of AD carries, Sivir versus Graves, you might in the past have thought these are both very early game focused carries, but in this meta where there's so many tanks, Sivir can get into the front line, lose all her abilities for damage, doesn't lose any damage, isn't zoned away, has to respect assassins most of the time, but now is so tanky and has so many defensive options and a Banshee Veil to get through that. If you don't have to respect assassins, Sivir does a lot of damage.
She does, and we've noted this when Sivir gets a fight with her tanks. That's the way you've described it, and that's exactly what happens. Uzi never wanted to shy away from melee combat on his AD carry either. I mean, it doesn't feel like an Uzi champion when you first think about it, but watching him play it and how they play with it as a team, it just suits him so well.
It just suits OMG, like you mentioned. It's been by far their most winning combination. It's not always just the Sivir Hecarim, which I believe they piloted back in week 4 of the LPL, but these combinations, they look so, so strong on, and QG just don't have the damage to dissuade them.
Uzi's tanking a turret right now. He's so confident with the Mikhail's there ready as well for amazing, and all the peel and just how strong his frontline is. QG lose the turret. That's the fifth now for OMG versus only three for QG, and the push is not stopping.
I don't know if it makes Uzi happy or sad that the only win with Sivir, the more teamfighter utility champion on the player, known for his hyper carry performances, but if this game confirms anything, look, we already knew that Sivir's pretty damn good, but OMG with Sivir look a completely different team. Even with a new lineup, the same Uzi Sivir brings out the best in them. So if we don't start seeing Sivir bans against at least OMG, I think it's just honestly a mistake.
I think so too, and a big minion stack in the top wave going to be tended to by Gnar, actually. Xiang will pick that up. That is, yes, a giant stack of minions there. Double cannons, they're going to shoot that down, but Xiang should make it in time to cut it off.
Is going to be the Black Cleaver coming through from Swift. A luxury Black Cleaver, but he's probably going to need to do the damage that TNT will not be doing. Maybe he'll be able to make up for TNT's lack of damage. And hell, the 30% armor shred. You already have a lot of innate attack speed when you queue as Rek'Sai, so maybe she can do the 30% armor shred to try and amplify some of the Graves damage that just wasn't really affecting the front line of OMG whatsoever.
No, and cool, clearing up waves in the bottom side. Void Staff added now as well, so massive damage with the double need to see larger items. Might even look for a Ludens as the last item just for extra flat ability power and a bit more wave clear. Xiang now nice and tanky with a Thornmail Warmogs to add into the Banshees and Randuin's. OMG, about 8,000 gold ahead, but it feels like quite a bit more at this point.
It does. There's no objective for them to fight over, so that gives Swift another minute or so to try and finish this Black Cleaver that he's been working towards. You can tell from the Phage and Kindle Gem in his build. There's theoretically other ways for him to go, but given the order that he's built these items, it's most likely going to be the Black Cleaver to try and augment TNT's damage, and I guess to some degree V's damage as well.
And Swift probably does have to carry here at this point. You mentioned they sort of need a secondary threat. I think Swift's a decent candidate. He's got 4,000 health built up already. Going to get a bit more of that when he finishes the Black Cleaver, I believe. Goes back now, probably has enough for it. He's a split-pushed menace as well. QG have to get creative to find ways to win this game.
So purchases the Black Cleaver. Now he's going to rush back to top lane. Can they win a team fight? And what does it look like? To me, it's a pick or nothing for QG because this five-man team from OMG is so strong.
Well, we're going to have a five-man potentially. OMG again, Uzi just tanking the turrets, but chunks them out so hard, even as the Fuhrer enchant in his boots now as well. And with the Banshees plus Spell Shield and the Orianna Shields, he's so safe in the front lines.
The poke is just tickling Orianna. Only able to use the Q, so the Sigil of Malice is probably not going to do too much damage to an Orianna that has had the Athenes. It just has so many shielding options in the back line. Very nice minion wave pushed by QG in the bottom lane. You can see blue pings onto it, so one person's already backing away. Maybe this will be enough to alleviate pressure. I just wonder, what are they building towards? What is QG's hope to get back into this game? We say the word pick, but unless they can really maybe just sell all their yellow trinkets for red trinkets and upgrade them and just deny every piece of vision, bait out the clairvoyance option that Sivir's picked up and then go for a kill. Maybe they can get the pick that way, but in any other way, in the late game, why walk into an unwarded brush if you're OMG?
Well, Swift has set up a good situation. They're ignoring the minion wave in the bottom side, and Baron has just spawned back up. So maybe the answer is Desperation Baron. Uzi's at Dragon, by the way, but QG, without that knowledge, do not pull the trigger.
If he was spotted out, this would be a different game. But with no vision on that side of the map, only a couple of tunnels for the potential split push, Uzi gets an absolutely free, critical third dragon for OMG.
I mean, if Uzi wasn't moving forward fast enough here in these teamfights with the ulti and the passive, that dragon's going to help out a bit more. And again, it's not a classic Uzi champion, but short range, best when moving forward with the tanks, or can outplay people with Spell Shield. It doesn't seem like it at first glance, but Sivir really is an Uzi champion, has certainly become one.
Looking aggressive.
Yeah, Swift could be in trouble. Xiong going to dive in. Shui Shui, good ultimate. They're going to find onto Swift, but he might just be able to get out of it slow. And the knock-up coming in as well. Great hook there from Amazing and Swift. That will seal his fate there. Uzi even popped his ulti just to make sure they got the kill. And now Doinbi actually could be the next one in, but Cool going to zone them out with the ball, and OMG will stop Baron.
If Doinbi has the right idea, feels like if he can burst out the jungler Zhue Zhue, then he'll be able to stop the Baron pressure, except this jungler is super, super tanky. Even has Orianna shields to ride upon. 6,000 health. Doinbi is the only option here.
He has to try and steal it. Goes in. No, Gragas does get it. Ulti onto TNT. Shockwave looking for it. Cool flashes over. Everyone's over the wall there as well. Hook's landing in. Gragas somehow gets a double kill. Xiong now going to chase in onto V. Try and chase down the Aurelia. Bit of a futile thing potentially. Mega Knight is there. Oh, no, did miss there. So Xiong not quite ready, but they'll just push down the mid lane.
Yeah, not getting valuable Gnar practices, Xiong. It hasn't been about Xiong whatsoever this game, but he will still be on the winning team. QG did a lot of things right, but honestly, their own aggression has outdone them in this particular situation. Specifically, Doinbi in the mid lane, using both his Mimic and his Distortion just liberally for no reason whatsoever, disregarding the multiple members from OMG. Disregard OMG at your own peril.
Yeah, and OMG looking stronger now. TNT eats a Gragas ulti. Turret's falling down, and Uzi doesn't care. He's going to go straight in and fight Swift. Going to get shredded. TNT getting ripped as well. Cool gets the first kill. Uzi claims the second. V going to get Shockwave back in for one final kill. Xiong dives into the fountain. Nautilus goes down, and Uzi claims the victory for his team.
Big win for OMG, and honestly, a bit of a surprise, whether it's based on their first round performances as the smiling Uzi returns, or it's based on the first 10 minutes of this game. It was looking so good for QG. Swift and Doinbi, the Korean duo of mid and jungle, were completely on the same wavelength. But after a dragon start went awry and four kills came over to OMG, they piloted this game, getting the gold and getting the advantage onto Uzi. It's not a surprise. Multiple teams have found this to be true. It's the way to victory.
Yeah, 9-1 and 14, I believe, for Uzi's final score. 100 CS ahead of TNT by the end of the match there as well. And Uzi, what more to say about a player, even on a champion like Sivir?
The Graves pick, I think, is a bit questionable. They tried to go for an early power spike champion. Lucian, perhaps, would have been the better call to kind of split the difference in that particular situation. Uzi on Sivir and OMG with Sivir. much, much stronger team, and GG well played to them.
Yep, strong stuff, but there is a game still left to play. Don't go too far away, because when we return, game two between OMG and Q.